So I'm going to start by defining more or less what I'm going to do in the introduction of the problem, then the methodology we have followed, and then we're going to, the process is going one by one, analyzing the main losses, optical losses that you cannot avoid. So any losses that we have, that we can avoid, and we'll go into that later, we are not considering, because we are looking for the upper limit, something that you can, let's say, improve towards the maximum. This is something that, well, there is no upper limit to that, but there are things that do have intrinsic limitation that you cannot, that you are not going to ever be able to overcome, and this is the one that we want to address, and we want to analyze what are the limitations and how much you can do really in a real system. So I'm going to be talking about I cannot move now, so far away from whatever it is. So I'm going to be talking about the limits of solar power technology, and in principle, how much is the first stage is how much we can collect the sunlight and send this sunlight to the receiver. So the system that we're going to be considering is the heliotrope field that is tracking the sun and concentrating the sun in the receiver, and the receiver envelope, the geometry of the receiver, because that will determine the amount of energy that we can concentrate on the receiver. Of course, after that, after you have been managed to bring a lot of light to the receiver, then you have to transform this light into this radiant energy into thermal energy, and then the thermal energy you have to transform in the current state of the art, you transform in the enthalpy of a working fluid, typically a molten salt, and then you have a heat exchanger and you run a compressor. So we are going to discuss only the what we call the light collection and concentration subsystem that includes the receiver, the heliotrope field, plus the geometry, the external geometry of the receiver that is capturing the sunlight. And we want to try to see what are the best that you can do with the current technology, and try to draw some conclusions about that. So I'm going to be talking mainly about the optical efficiency, and what is important when you are designing a heliostat, one of the systems, is not the instantaneous optical efficiency or the optical efficiency in the what is called sometimes the design point at the midday or some nice day, either in the solstice or the equinox, etc. What is important is the annual optical efficiency, because this is about collecting energy and not about establishing a given amount of power at a given moment. So what are the kind of losses that we're going to have since the sunlight reaches the mirrors of the heliostat field until it reaches the receiver? Well, you're going to have atmosphere. When it reaches the one is reflected, you have atmospheric attenuation from going from the heliostat to the receiver, and that depends on the characteristic length of the heliostat field, the distance from the heliostat to the receiver, and the characteristic of your atmosphere. Then you are going to have receiver shadow. That is, the receiver is not drawn here, but the receiver, because it's a solid thing and it's intersecting, is, let's say, so pale, is casting a shadow on the heliostat field. You are going to have also the mirror reflectivity, typically is not 100, so you are going to have losses because part of the sunlight is going to be absorbed in the heliostat field, in the heliostat, in the mirrors of the heliostat. Then you are going to have the cosine factor, that is due to the fact that the incident light is not normal to the surface of the heliostat all the time, and that decreases the efficiency of the heliostat per unit area. The spillage is that the heliostat are sending the energy to the receiver, but because the sun has an angular aperture, even if the heliostat starts to concentrate, the beam of the receiver is always increasing, the beam from the heliostat to the receiver, and well, depending on the size of the receiver, you will be able to capture all the energy on the reflected rays or not. The fraction that you are not capturing is what is called the spillage factor. Then you have the shadowing and blocking of the heliostat among themselves. So some heliostat will cast shadows on another heliostat, and some heliostat will reflect the energy to the receiver, but the energy, instead of the light, instead of reaching the receiver, will reach the back of another headless, that is what we call blocking. Typically, blocking and shadowing, you have to consider both the kind of limitation of my movement. So, typically, shadowing and blocking, you have to consider them together, because something that is in shadow could also be potentially in block if we were not in shadow. So, what you are interested is in the overall efficiency, and then. Well, you have tracking errors and other things that we are not going to consider, because, as I said, what we are going to try to see what are the upper limits, how is the best that we can do. So, I will go into the analysis later. I'm going to tell you now what is the state of the art. Right now, I don't know why. Well, I know why. A lot of people, when they try to do optimization of heliostat fields, they always compare with the PS10, that is the first solar power plant that was commercial in Spain. It was built by Abengoa. It's a 10 megawatt power plant with a steam receiver. It was the first that I think was entered into operation in 2006, more or less. And I think they published a paper in which they put the coordinates of the heliostat field. And because many other power plants, you have the information, but you don't have the heliostat field, really the layout of the heliostat field. So many researchers have taken this layout and say, can we do it better? Okay. And they have tried to do it better with different strategies of placing the heliostat on the field. Okay. So you see that for PS10, it's a relatively small plant. We will talk later about what is unweighted and unweighted optical efficiency. Unweighted is the optical efficiency without considering the DNI. I will explain later, but the unweighted efficiency, annual efficiency, is 64%, and the weighted 69%. You will see when this is unweighted efficiency, these teams claim that they have obtained 0.09 more. They will manage to write a paper on this small advantage. Then these ones with this pattern-free approach, they gain 1%. This is weighted efficiency. This unweighted efficiency. These are a lot of different reporting in the literature. You really need to be careful, because some of them they consider reflectivity, some of them they don't consider reflectivity. It's really a tricky thing. We have tried to take away and to compare just without the reflectivity 100, but you see that more or less for this small plant, the maximum efficiency that people are getting is optical efficiency, annual optical efficiency, of the order of 70%. Okay. So before reaching the receiver, we are already losing 30% of the energy in this kind of system. And this is for a small plant in which the transmissivity losses are not important and the cosine factor are also not really important. When you go to larger plant, the traditional 50 megawatt or 100 megawatt plant, then the optical efficiency is more of the order of the 60, 62 than 70. So, what are we going to do in order to achieve what are the upper limits of what is the best that we can do? We are going to run a very ideal experiment and try to analyze and try to see if we can get out of this ideal concept some insight about what is the limiting factors and what are the most important factors that affect the optical efficiency, the annual optical efficiency of heliostat fields. So the first thing we are going to consider is ideal heliostat. Our ideal heliostat is tiny, it's completely small, has perfect reflectivity, 1 or 100, whatever you want to call it, perfect solar tracking, we don't have any problem solar tracking, and it's magic, it doesn't have shadowing and blocking. You cannot do better than that, you cannot be better than magic. So any areas that in real life will have shadowing and blocking, so these ones can be all putting all one too near each other, and not having any losses. So this, to me, is clearly that it's an upper limit. The thing is, it's a very unrealistic upper limit or not. This is the second question. Then, we want to inquire for a given mirror field, a heliostat field of a given mirror area. half a million square meters of mirrors or 1 million square meters of mirrors. We want to analyze what is the best annual efficiency that we can get with the best heliostat that we can find, but this little heliostat that are really completely tiny. So the ideal heliostat field for a given mirror area will be the set of ideal heliostat that with the highest annual optical efficiency will achieve the given area that we have. So it's an integration that you have for the area, and you calculate in any point on the plane what will be the efficiency of a little heliostat with no shadowing and blocking in that point on the plane, and that will be the heliostat that will be the efficiency of that heliostat of differential area. And then by integrating the whole thing, you can say, well, if my heliostat field is small, then maybe the annual optical efficiency can be 90%. But if it starts to be large, we will see later how the optical efficiency decreases because of the cosine factor, etc. So what we are going to analyze is what are the different losses that we cannot avoid ever, and what are the impact of these losses on the annual optical efficiency, and what can you do? So of the thing that I explained before, the thing that we cannot avoid is the atmospheric attenuation. We cannot clean the atmosphere with water, but it's not realistic. So this is something that we can, for a specific location, the atmospheric attenuation depends on the location, and we cannot do anything about this. The other thing that we cannot do anything is about the receiver channel. The receiver has to be opaque, because if it's transparent, they will not capture the sunlight. So we cast a shadow on the heliostat field, and those heliostat that are the shadow of the receiver will not be able to be active and also send light to that. This is typically a small factor, but we want to include it in order to really consider that, let's say, a upper limit, but it's realistic. So mirror reflectivity we are not going to consider because, well, you can, now we have mirrors of the order of between 92 to 96% reflectivity, and people can be improved. And also, theoretically, you can have mirrors of 100% reflectivity using internal reflection, but it's not easy and it's not cheap. Okay. So we are not going to consider this. Cosine factor is something that we cannot change. Well, I sometime ago I proposed to develop a material with some people that was working for NASA to develop a material that did not follow the Descartes' law. We did not got the project, and I think I'm completely somehow happy because I never was quite sure that a material of this kind would not violate the second law of thermodynamics. But people have been trying to, there are some attempts to create metamaterials or something like that may not follow the Descartes law, and therefore you may, play with the cosine factor, but this is, we are not going there. So we are going to consider that we are going to have normal mirrors, that we cannot avoid the cosine factor because of the tracking. The spillage we cannot avoid either, because when we fix the size of the receiver, the spillage and the receiver channel, and they say interplay. If you want to capture all the rays from the heliostat field, the receiver has to have a large size or a larger size. If you want to decrease the shadow of the receiver on the field, you would like the shadow of the receiver to be small. So there is room for optimization because there are two different tendencies, and then, as I said, shadowing and blocking, we are completely considering that our heliostat are magic, and we are not considering this because you can improve the heliostat and blocking by a clever positioning of the heliostat. Of course, you can claim that depending on the density that you want, you can never achieve this, but still, for a upper limit study, I think is appropriate. And the rest, we are considering that you can improve the tracking, etc., etc., and the surface, the properties, the slow errors of the heliostat. What I said about the weighted annual efficiency is that, of course, it's not the same for a heliostat to have a high efficiency in the morning when the solar radiation is 100 watt per square meter than to be higher efficiency at noon when you have 1,000 watt per square meter. So what we're interested is in the optical efficiency multiplied by the direct normal irradiance. So you give more importance to have optical efficiency with the optical irradiance, that optical irradiance is high. So this is the efficiency that we are going to be focusing more. So we already talked about this.
So now we're going to go one by one. We're going to introduce first the cosine factors, then the other factors, and then put in, everything together and see what we get. But the kind of analysis are going to be similar. So this is, well, clearly the cosine factor, this is the receiver, a heliostat, and by Descartes' law of reflection, the angle of the reflected ray with the normal of the heliostat have to be equal to the number of the incident rays, so these two angles are the same, and you have to have all this all the time when you are tracking the sun. Depending on the position of the heliostat on the heliostat field, and depending on the position on the direction of the sun, the orientation of the sun in a given moment of the day, you will have this is changing during the whole day. The cosine factor depends on the tower height, depends on the sun position and the latitude of the place, and depends also on the heliostat position, and therefore at the global level depends on the field size. Because the larger the size, the more options you have for different positions with respect to the tower. This is for a latitude of 20 degrees north and a tower height of 100 meters. You see that the cosine factors, the annual cosine, the annual cosine in this area is 88%. In all these areas, and we were discussing yesterday that when you put the heliostat in the other side of the tower, if that makes sense. Well, you see that the heliostat in the other side of the tower, in the wrong side of the tower, they have 67, very low efficiency compared to the one that are in the appropriate size. But still, depending on how large is the heliostat field, and we will see that, you may consider this appropriate or not. So, what we have done? We have done analyze the cosine factor for a lot of tower height and a lot of annual efficiency. You will see in many studies, especially in the 80s, that you do this in a dimensionless way. Because at the end, what is important for the cosine factor is the ratio between the distance to the heliostat field to the tower and the height of the tower. And you can do this dimensionalize the whole thing by dividing by the height of the tower, and then you get a nice plot. But this will work for the cosine factor. As soon as you introduce transmissivity losses, then the non-dimensionality of the analysis drops down, because the transmissivity losses are directly proportional to the actual length and not to the proportion between the sides. So that's why all the analysis here, even though in this case we could do a non-dimensional analysis, is done with a specific dimension. So this is tower height, and this is the mean annual efficiency, and we have been considering heliostat field of different sizes. How do I fix the size of the heliostat field? What I do is I consider in the previous slide or in the what we do is we calculate the efficiency of all the points in this area, and then we sort all the pixels or all the little heliostat by the efficiency that they have, and all of them they have a given amount of area, so we put in order of efficiency, and we stop when we get the total area that we are interested in, and that gives us the shape, the boundary of the heliostat field. So a small heliostat field, less than 0.1 km square, you get this kind of heliostat. Larger heliostat field starts to be a circular heliostat. You see even that the smaller heliostat field, there are some interest on having heliostat to the north of the tower. To the opposite side of the tower. But it's interesting to see also the shape, how the shape of the heliostat changes with the, in this case, with the size of the heliostat field. And this is for a latitude of 20 degrees. This is an analysis also of the, well, you look, one interesting thing of the previous thing is that when you start getting good efficiency, first, there is an asymptotic behavior. So at some point it doesn't make economic sense to try to make a tower larger, etc., because what you are going to gain is not going to compensate for the increase in the height of the tower. But you see that the optimum is of the order of more than 200 meters, 200, 250 meters tower. And if you look at the industry, this is what they're doing. The latest tower we were in was a satellite, I think it's 250 meters. That means that they also know how to calculate the cosine. The cosine factor, which is a good news. So this is as a function of the tower height, but what we're analyzing here is the effects of latitude. In the previous one, we were analyzing the effect of the heliostat field size, on the shape of the head of the boundaries of the heliostat field. And here what we are analyzing is the effect of latitude on the behavior of the heliostat field. You see, for low latitude, of course, you get a symmetric the equator, you get a symmetric field with to have a tower measure of 50 meters. When you get the latitudes, very high latitudes, then the field starts to be north field fairly. And here, depending on the, this is for a tower of 1,000 meters, you still get a very similar thing. Okay. Well, with the latitude, when the tower gets high, what is interesting with the latitude is that the heliostat field starts to be more interesting to be far away from the tower. The whole north heliostat field and very far away from the tower. I mean, this is, I don't know if you find that interesting, but I think it is. And also, you look again, the tower height is always in this region, and you can have some flip of depending on the latitude that you are, something is more interesting. So conclusion: for you can see that the small fields perform better than larger fields because of the green cosine in the case of the cosine, but you will have asymptotic behavior that compare for taller towers, independent of the heliostat size, and that also the short towers perform better at higher latitudes. This is also what we were saying here. The performance of this is better than this, because we are not putting there the latitude, but I think it is in the graphic, you can see that 60 is below. So, well, this is a summary of the whole thing that you can see. And I think, this is some interesting things to take. Now, we are going to introduce, in addition to the cosine factor, the attenuation. No, we are not going to consider attenuation by itself, because attenuation will be circular efficiency, depending on the distance of the heliostat to the tower. But the product of this product, as I said, you cannot non-dimensionalize, so you need to do it as we have been doing already for the cosine factor. And well, you have to, of course, when you are trying to consider the attenuation, you have to have a model of your atmosphere. And we are there several in the literature. For this study, we consider this model that have been put forward for BTTOE and BIGS. You have to be careful with this, and this is something that is important, because some of these models are just correlations that have been adjusted with some measurements that were taken at some point. And sometimes these correlations are only valid for a range of values. I found when we were, and many of the correlations, well, this is BTTOE and BIGS is from the 70s, or at the beginning it was the heaviest very, very old time. And some of these correlations, they don't work when the distance is more than 1 kilometer, or 1.5 kilometers. And now some of the towers, people are designing towers that have this larger characteristic length. And what is interesting, if you put this distance of more than 1 kilometer here, you start to get better performance the farther away you have your statistics, because it's not easy because the model is going in the other direction. So if you are not careful and you are using a wrong model, you can get a completely wrong conclusions based on that. And I have seen some papers that were using models and they were outside the limits of the length of the variable. So here the D is the slam range, is the distance directly from the heliostat to the receiver, this distance for each one of the points. Of course, as I said, the permissivity by itself is just a circular model, but then you import this circle into the cosine, and then you get more interesting chain. Before they were more circular, etc., were based on the geometry alone. This is, you start getting penalized when you are going farther away. So do now some of these conclusions that we had before, some of this field that they wanted to go in the, let's say, remember that there was a field in this previous field that wanted to be very, this one. This is the heliostat field now. This is for the cosine factor, makes sense the chain, but when you start penalizing the heliostat by the permissivity, then this is going to, the heliostat here, they have lower cosine but better transmissivity, so the chain is going to get what we are getting. It's going to get more in this kind of chain. Again, we did the same exercise from heliostat field from 0.1 kilometer to 1.5 kilometers. You can say the difference in for the same latitude. You can see the same figure, but now consider now, you see that the limits are more clear. The asymptotic behavior is still there, but for very large towers. It's independent, so the behavior of the field is independent of the size of the tower is very high, but this is a 1 kilometer tower, which is completely unrealistic. But you still see that the interesting thing, at least for small fields, is in this field, and the larger the field, you have to go to higher towers. 400, and this is, to me, one of the conclusions of this is that really you have a problem, you have a limitation on the efficiency, and this is the best that you can do. So we're saying that even if you get a 400 meter tower, if your heliostat field is 1.5 square kilometers of mirror, you're going to get an efficiency that is less than 80% annual optical efficiency. Same play now with the latitude. This is for latitude of 60 degrees. Latitude of 60 degrees. You see that the latitude of 60 degrees with a big tower now is, let's say, closer to the tower than it was before, just with the cosine factor because of the penalization of this thing. So you see again the play of the different. This is for 50 meters. This is a very small tower. How the shape changed with the latitude, and this is how the tower for 1,000. The 50 and 100, 1,000 meters down. You see the difference. And now we're going to increase to also consider the shadow of the receiver on the field and the spillage of the receiver. So what we are going to do in this case, we need to make some assumption. We make a simplification because we consider we didn't consider the shadow of the tower, because the tower you can also include the shadow of the tower a lot by doing very very light towers or tower without also, let's say, air in the middle or transparent tower, etc. But the receiver has to be opaque, and but we make a simplification that is not the best that you can do. We consider the receiver a spherical receiver, because it was the easiest way that we can do the simulation. Later, and I thought that yesterday, I think tomorrow I will talk about this. We develop a program called Flux Tracer that gives you the ideal receiver that you can have to capture all the rays from a heliostat field. And the ideal receiver, not the one that you would like to build, the one that will be more compatible with still capturing all the rays. But we didn't, let's say, for this study, we didn't do that. We did this approximation that the receiver will be a spherical receiver. So we consider, well, this is what of course, the bigger the receiver, the less the spillage, and the more the receiver channel, so it's interplay. And we consider, we did an optimization, we consider a receiver for every one, for every position of the tower we want to analyze. We consider we are going to put a receiver that has a sphere of 1 meter until, until 13 meters of radius. And then we got the best configuration that give us the maximum, let's say the best performance in the shadowing, the shadowing and blocking of the shadowing and the spillage was best, the minimum amount of loss that we can gain. When you get a spherical receiver, you get the main thing is just the angle, the solid angle that you intercept with the receiver. And it depends on the receiver dimension, the tower height, the sun position, and the heliostat position of the field, the velocity that you have. So we did that, let's say, we calculate also the shadow, the heliostat that were in the shadow of the receiver. That was the previous one was for the calculation of the spillage, and this was for the calculation of the shadow. It looks simple, but we did a lot of millions of calculations to do this thing. And at the end, you really don't perceive too much the thing. What you, I don't know if I have some figures here, but at the end, what you perceive is a little area in the heliostat field where the receiver, the shadow that the receiver was cast, and you have some also noise because of the during the whole annual performance on some. But then the influence is almost, well, it's very little, but still we did it for the, you see that when you compare it, we have, like, have a comparison of the efficiency, the behavior didn't affect the overall behavior what we have before. And the thing that we did is the optimum of the receiver, this optimum receiver radius as a function of the latitude and for field sizing from 1 to 3.5 kilometers square. And well, you can see the tower height, how it influences a little on the best size of the receiver. So, you, for instance, when you have a relatively small tower and the field size is this is 1.5, this is small, then the size of the receiver is the optimum size of the receiver is the radius of the receiver is 2 meters. When you increase the size of the heliostat field, these are the increases that you are starting to get on the radius of the receiver. And this is what you want to see. I don't know if it's this is this little break here is the effect of the channel. And here you really need to look over here, but this is the more clear that you see the effects of the receiver shadow on the but it's a relatively tiny effect that is making some few areas of the heliostat field not looking as this. So we found less than 1% difference with the plot without considering the losses because of the receiver shadow, so these are relatively negligible in comparison to the rest. And the receiver radius should be optimum with the minimum radius, but it's the minimum radius of the capture of the rest. So we felt that was an interplay, but really the main thing was to minimize the shadow. This is the field receiver radius can be larger for a small tower than large tower. Because of the, it was because of the challenge. So, the conclusion is that this is, well, for the, this is, we did the study, again, for PS10, This is the original PSTN design. The biomimetic, one of the best thing about the cosine and the attenuation. This is what we get in the ideal field, and the efficiency, that the weighted efficiency that that we get for our ideal field. Well, this is, sorry, the thing is, here we're not completely, because it's unweighted, and this is weighted, but we didn't find the data for this thing. But the thing is, well, this is for the small tower system, as I said before, as you have seen before, the for large system, the efficiencies are of the order, let me show here, I think this is the most clear one. For large systems, the efficiencies are, the maximum efficiencies are between less than 80%. For towers, well, the tower made 200, you get less than 75%, and for towers between, I think the more realistic thing, 250 or something like that, or 300, you will get 78% efficiency, the best that you can do. Of course, you don't do this in the real world. In real life, and this is what explains the limitation, in my view, of one tower system. So what I would like to talk tomorrow is about what happened is instead of one tower, we try to have several towers, and we have to try to aim the heliostat from one tower to another, depending on the time of the day, if we can improve this substantially or not. Other thing that we can do, and we have been discussing, but it's not easy, is how to incorporate in an upper limit study the blocking and shadow. We need to get, because we would like to get upper limits that are realistic, but still clearly complete the upper limits. One thing that we, as a thing we can do is to improve the chain of the receiver, but to me, already the spherical doesn't have too much influence. Improving the chain of the receiver for every moment in time, and trying to, it would be really the upper limit, but I think a lot of work for just getting the second decimal number right about the upper limits. But introducing either a dilution factor, so that will give us, because we know that, for instance, the gram factor, the gram capacity factor of the commercial plants is on the order of 20%, more or less. And so you introduce this dilution factor here, and you want to get upper limits that still are much more realistic and can give you very good idea of how a real plant with a specific technology could achieve. And at the same time, to me, the interesting thing about these studies and this kind of modeling is that it gives you an overall idea of how all these things interplay with a simple, very simple model that people can understand. So if we introduce, for instance, dilution factors, and we start getting the real change of the real size of the heliostat field for a specific amount of mirror, I think that could be also an interesting idea, at least to start playing to see what different alternatives you may have in order to optimize a heliostat field. But again, this the thing about the model of blocking factor that still we can consider is more realistic because introducing the blocking factor, but it's always an upper limit, is something that we are discussing a lot, but it's not easy, so any suggestions are welcome. Okay. Do you have questions?
Yes. Yes, I would ask about the spillage losses. If you assume that the heliostats are infinitely small, then why is spillage still expected?
Because it doesn't matter if it's small or not. Every time you get the solar radiation, it's a cone of radiation, and I think we put it there here. You have an effect. You have you get from the sun a cone of radiation. You get a reflection, a cone, also a cone. And the farther away the larger this distance, the larger the pressure of the cone. Yeah.
questions?
Yes. I remember thinking about this problem a few years ago, and something I couldn't get my head around about the coastline losses, because I could be wrong about this, but like, it seems to me like when the mirrors have an infinitesimal size, they kind of, somehow the concept of a coastline loss becomes meaningless. Like if you imagine a field of infinitesimally small heliostats that's infinitesimally packed, then, like tightly packed, then basically you essentially have a reflective surface that is the size of your heliostat field that reflects all of the light that hits it, right? And so I think you can simply just take this area of the field and say all that light is reflected onto the tower, no matter what the height is. And so but at the same time, when I think about an individual heliostat, then I know that it has a different sort of a coastline loss associated with it, and I think that there's something happening in this limit that I can't get my head around.
Okay, no, but this is not, let's say, the coastline losses are there, you have to consider, it's like when you consider they are there also when you consider the typical transfer of energy between the typical equation of transfer between two surfaces. When you look at the view angles, you always have the cosine factor, and the surfaces are also infinitesimal surfaces. So you have to put that, otherwise it doesn't work.
I don't understand. But then I can't reconcile that with the fact that, I guess, with infinitesimally small heliostats, all the light that hits the field gets reflected, and so therefore you can simply just say, I have an oval heliostat field, I multiply the global, the horizontal, direct horizontal irradiance by the area of the field, and then I get my essential cosine of infinity of the, so.
Well, let's say, to me this is, we can go into the mathematics later. I think that you have to, really for the analysis and to get the upper limit, you have to consider. There's no way you can, this is the most relevant thing. You can say that what we are analyzing is the performance of a heliostat in a given position, okay. And this is given by the cosine factor, is the one of the leading term, right. in that position, independent of the size of the heliostat.
Okay, thanks.
Yes?
What is the error range for magnitudes?
Sorry?
The error interval, error bar. What is the error range? For instance, you define cosine efficiency is exact, but for spill energy, for attenuation factor, so what is the precision for this number? How many percent?
No, I didn't include that. For the attenuation, let's say, the attenuation we're considering the model, and the model, to give a precision range, you have to compare with something real. This is just a model. I'm considering a curve of attenuation, that is, so I don't consider any error there. And what are the other losses we're considering? The other thing, the geometry that we're considering, this is the complete thing, it's an ideal exercise. We're not considering that we are not measuring properly the size of the receiver.
I mean, the total efficiency of the flux, you see at least the protocol of optical efficiency and thermal efficiency. For thermal efficiency, as I know, a good precision is considered to be 15-20%. That means that if you have thermal efficiency, let's say 0.7, it might be 0.5 and 0.9. So, something like this. So, and that means that you should not pay a lot of attention to the thermal efficiency, and you should pay a lot of attention for the robustness. And this is a question from me. For the optical efficiency, because if you know exactly, so that this is a number, it's okay. But if the input parameters, at least for the attenuation factor, like humidity or dust or whatever, or for reflectivity, because reflectivity depends a lot from the cleanness of the surface. So that means that your optical efficiency, what you show in this flow, is not a straight line. This is a corridor.
No, for the upper limit, it's a straight line.
Yes, but the limit is a straight line. But the limit should be a corridor.
The right,
so
right,
state
right.
State
I cannot answer
state
to you that.
The
state
is very low, it must be.
Yeah. Yeah, no, no, for, let's say for the, this exercise, is, there is no error because it's an ideal exercise and we're considering we don't have error. When you are measuring in a real field, you have to compound all the efficiency, the effectivity, everything that you have, and yeah, you will have a binding of error. But what did you say about the receiver? Why do you say that the receiver efficiency is not
this is just a well-known fact that calculation of thermal efficiency is based on the heat transfer coefficients. Mm-hmm. And heat transfer coefficients, precision of heat transfer coefficients is considered to be good when it's about 15 or 20%, because it's based on the correlation. Mm-hmm. So, and if you look for any plot of heat transfer coefficients, vertical convection or in pipe or whatever, you will see logarithmic plot. But in logarithmic plot, so the small distance means about 10%.
Mm-hmm.
Because the show is a very high range of, mm-hmm. let's say, Reynolds parameter from 100 to 10,000. But your real range is very small. And then when they just replot heat transfer coefficients in the linear scale, not on the logarithmic scale, so they will see that many correlations differ from each other.
Mm-hmm.
And this difference might be, as I said, 20%. So that means any thermal efficiency based on heat transfer coefficients is known. Okay, so let's say 15%.
But my point was that.
And to the end, it results in error bars. I mean, so when you have any sort of efficiency, yeah. So you have an error bars depending on how precise are input parameters inside the simulation.
Yeah, but out of that you cannot get the conclusion is that you may measure better, but the conclusion also is that you need to get a receiver with good thermal efficiency, even if you don't know what the thermal efficiency is. Because otherwise, the thing is not working. So,
we're supposed to finish at 10:30?
It's 10,
yeah. 10?
It's 10 now.
But it was supposed to finish now?
No, it was supposed to be at 10:30.
10:30, okay.
Because this is, I wanted to introduce you, Professor Manuel Goyares Pereira, that is visiting us from the University of Évora. He's a specialist of non-imaging optics and many other things, so you can. And he's going to talk to you also about the different kind of optical analysis. And I think that would be also interesting.